Thanks for downloading this edition of The Why Factor from the BBC, a programme that seeks to find out why we do the things we do. I hope you enjoy it. Why do we like the music we like? That is the question I'll be investigating over the next hour. As part of the BBC World Service Identity season, I'll be asking whether we are genetically wired to choose the music we do, or if we learn our musical taste as we go along. What makes us choose Dolly, Dylan, or Daft Punk? Or love or hate all three? I'm Gemma Kearney, and on this journey, we head from the bottom of the planet to the top, hearing from fans, music makers, and experts from Chile to Iceland and beyond.
The music is part of who they are. It's part of what they see as important in the world. It's part of what they see as their personality and their view on the world.
You don't want to follow. You always want to lead. You always want to be original in some way.
I think we are searching something. All of us. We are trying to find our roots.
There are songs for the head, songs for the heart, and songs for the feet.
Music is where our humanity becomes manifest to ourselves, and I think that's one very important thing that music does.
What
is this I'm feeling?
What about you? What's on your playlist? And why have some artists transcended time and borders?
Okay.
Here we are at Lollapalooza day one. It's filled with really young, exuberant, overexcited Chilean teenagers, mostly, with their hands in the air. It's still only the afternoon, it's not even 2 p.m. yet. And there is a band on, an act called Movimiento Original. Movimiento Original are having it right now. Starting as we mean to go on. It's a kind of fusion of old school hip hop. There's a guy mixing like there's no tomorrow on stage. Huge screens with giant visuals of bases exploding in front of us. The sun is shining. Pretty damn cool, to be honest. Eminem, Florence and the Machine, Mumford & Sons, Noel Gallagher, Jungle. Sounds like a fantastic festival lineup. I mean, they could be headline acts for Glastonbury, but these British and American acts are drawing huge crowds thousands of miles away at the tip of southern South America. What do the fans make of it here in Santiago? Amazing sunglasses, a ring in the middle of nose, Batman trousers, looking fly, babes.
Thank you, you too.
So it's my first time in Chile.
Yeah, do you like it?
Yeah.
It's awesome.
It's so fun. And what's your vibe? What do you love stomping your feet to and having a dance to?
Today I'm going for Marina and the Diamonds. That's my jam.
Yeah?
So I want some pop music, dance a lot. That's my thing.
What do you think it is about Marina and the Diamonds, a British star coming all the way to Chile and igniting so many imaginations?
The thing is, she has a lot of fun songs, but if you get to listen to the lyrics, they're very sad. So it's a mix of things. You get to feel the music and also dance to it.
Which artists are you most excited about seeing?
I just watched 21 Pilots and I loved it. I watched Eminem yesterday. It was great. And I don't know, I'm just knowing new artists.
So you use Lollapalooza as a way to find new acts as well?
Yes, I bought the tickets without knowing who was going to come. So I was just expecting to get surprised.
That's pretty cool.
I'm super excited. I'm like, this is the best festival that we can have in Chile. I love it.
Why do you love it so much?
Well, because, I mean, it's like a multicultural experience. You have bands from all over the world. You have people from all over the world also. And that's something that you can have any place here in Chile, because it's not like a cosmopolitan country, you know? But this place, you have culture, you have music, you have art, you have people. It's fantastic.
So here we are in the press area with Jungle.
Hello.
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 Who would have thought? Here we are in South America.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it?
It's pretty great.
It's pretty hot.
Going pretty much the whole way around the other side of the world, which is always fun.
Loads of the acts on the main stage today are English speaking. What is it when it comes to the dominance of English speaking sound?
I think it's because, like, what the American and British music industries are much bigger.
It's
like, they're the two biggest markets in the world. So naturally, more acts are going to get more money, more exposure globally. Yeah. I think it's really down to that. I don't think it's necessarily...
It's got to be down to American culture as well, yeah. And films, the fact that a lot of films are always in English, you know. A lot of the big blockbusters, because of the money in America, which means English is sort of a universal sort of language through some of the arts.
Another thing that has been absolutely mind-boggling but brilliant is how resonant British music is here. Mm-hmm. And is this a Chilean thing? Am I going to find that everybody loves Noel Gallagher, or is this happening here?
Noel Gallagher, oh my God, everyone does love Noel Gallagher. I'm like, everyone learns Pink Floyd song. I think, what did I learn on the guitar first? Pink Floyd and Oasis, of course.
Why?
I don't know. Like, that's what they taught me.
The UK is pretty far away.
I know,
what is
I know.
This?
And it's so funny because I think Chileans, like, feel like they're from the UK somehow, like, oh yeah, the Beatles, yeah, Chilean. as if I don't know, there is a strong heritage. I think it has to do with, on the one side, incredible references that resonate with certain Chilean qualities. Like, I do think the Chilean cultural sensibilities have to do with, you know, very poetic and very dark and very romantic, and I feel like you have like that William Blake thing, you know, like it's always very poetic and very lonely and very artsy in a way, but at the same time very rigorous. Like, I do feel like the British rock scene, like if you look at the Kinks or the Who or the Beatles, like they're super influential. Like, every kid here learns who they are and will study a song from them, I guarantee you. You know, it's like, it's very relevant, and people, I think, go to like the school of UK rock in a way.
That was Chilean pop star Francisca Valenzuela. But is there something more going on here in Chile? We spoke to some of the new wave of Chilean artists and found out how they feel about the dominance of English language music.
I'm Javier Amena. I'm from Chile, from here. And I have 4 albums. My music is electropop and sometimes ballads. I do pop music, but independent pop music.
Do you feel a pressure as a big artist to be able to sing in English as well as Spanish? Do you feel like there's a sense that that will elevate your career?
I am a writer, so I write my songs. So for write, I have to feel, and I can't feel in English.
We also got to talk to Jefe, another rising star of Chilean pop music. His musical identity owes nothing to the Anglosphere.
I don't want to sing in English, but it's not necessary to sing in English. Maybe now it's most important to begin to sing in Chinese or Korean, I don't know.
I want to make my own songs and my own stuff, because that is the most important for us here in Chile. Chile is a small country, but the Chilean audience is awesome. I don't need the world for now. The key for us is to make music from here to the world.
How are our musical tastes formed wherever we are in the world? To understand this, we have to go right back to the beginning, even before we take our first breath.
My name is Dr. Victoria Williamson, and I direct the Music and Wellbeing Research Unit at the University of Sheffield. Really, before we're born, we are developing a musical sense. So musical responses we see in fetal development and in brand new babies, where they already have some of the musicality that is going to help them develop a musical sense as they grow older. And as each of us grow and are exposed to the music of our own culture, we develop more and more specialized musical skills. And whether we train or not, our musical minds continue to grow throughout life.
What about the idea of babies stopping crying to certain relaxing classical music? Is that a real thing?
It's certainly true that many, many babies respond to music. One of the fascinating findings is the idea that very, very young babies respond in a way that makes us think they remember music that they've heard played in the womb. And we know that because when babies are exposed to music when they're still in utero and then they come out and hear that same music, we see physiological responses associated with relaxation, and they go to sleep quicker and they stay asleep for longer. The brain never, never stops learning about music.
In the womb, I listened to a lot of UB40. And by the time I was a teenager, like a moth to the flame, I'd immersed myself in all things pop. Though the charts were pretty varied in 99, I was 14 and loved all sorts, from the Spice Girls to Tupac to Garage. I enjoyed music that made me feel something, be it girl power, anything that put a pep in my step, or I could learn a dance routine to.
You tend to like the music that your cohort, your peer group like.
Daniel Levitin is professor of psychology at McGill University in Canada and a former record producer.
You find that in public schools and private schools, you know, before the age of 18 or 19, certain groups of people dress alike and they talk alike and they listen to similar music as one another. And you're, in effect, forging a social identity that way. And, oh, those people over there, you know, we would never listen to what they listen to. It would make us seem uncool or unhip or not part of the group.
There are a couple of reasons why teenage years into the early 20s form a particularly strong role in the development of musical preferences for most people. And partly that has to do with the normal body and brain changes that are going on around that period of time. So there's a lot more hormones going through the system that can make events and experiences more emotional. Another factor is many of the things that people are encountering in that period of life, they're encountering for the first time. And we know there's an influence of novelty on memory as well, so you're more likely to recall and retain those experiences as part of who you are. And the other thing is this memory theory called reminiscence bumps, which is that there are these peaks of memory experience which tend to be quite telling for the way that we develop as people. And there's a reminiscence bump definitely around teenage years. When the crowd say ball, selector.
When the crowd say ball, selector. So what shapes our musical evolution after our teenage years? How do we find a way to open our minds up to different genres, styles and sounds?
People differ from one another in thousands of ways. And one of them is our openness to new experience. This is one of the fundamental ways that we differ from each other. And I'm sure, Gemma, you know people who, you know, you go out to dinner with them and you try and decide where to go and they want to eat at the same restaurant they always go to. And once they get there, they order the exact same thing. And then you probably know other people who are more adventuresome and they want to go to a new place and try new dishes. And we see this in musical taste as well. Some people really just want to hear the music of their youth over and over again, or music that sounds like it. Other people want to be constantly challenging themselves with new music. And of course, millions of people fall somewhere in between.
I believe that people can become very, very keen on certain music and very strongly willed about their preferences, mostly because the music is part of who they are. It's part of what they see as important in the world. It's part of what they see as their personality and their view on the world. So it's an expression. It's a cover, as a book cover would be. It tells that person something that's important about their inner being. So they're arguing as much for themselves as they are for just the music.
What about some of the musicians that we're hearing from in this program? What shaped their musical tastes? First, here's Chilean Javier Amena.
Well, I listened a lot of music when I was a little child. I listened a lot of English music, like Pet Shop Boys. It was one of my favorites.
British band Jungle. Why don't think you trust? What was your scene, age 14? What were you wearing and what were you listening to?
I think it was a bit of a weird one because we were sort of into sort of heavier music, like System of a Down. And grunge, as well as sort of like UK hip hop, like Task Force and Jest and Brain Tax and a very UK sort of scene.
Wasn't it? Like we
so
love
the top
like,
half was like, well, the lower half was like baggy jeans and chains. The top half was like flat caps.
It's all wrong.
All wrong.
Come over to the window, my little darling.
Georg Holm from Sigur Rós.
I love Leonard Cohen, for example, and the reason why, I think, is because every time my parents drove me to school in the morning, they would always have a tape, which people don't know what it is anymore, but in the car with Leonard Cohen on it. And so every single morning I would listen to Leonard Cohen, and I still love Leonard Cohen. Before I let you take me
home. To dissect our music listening patterns, I spoke to Elliot Van Buskirk from popular music streaming service Spotify about what music fans are listening to.
We started working with this concept called distinctiveness, which looks at, you know, what is disproportionately listened to, say, in a country versus all other countries in the world where there's Spotify. So you can tease out some very interesting things along those lines. We looked at two very different age groups, millennials and baby boomers, and ran this math to find out what artists do millennials listen to a lot that almost no baby boomers listen to, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. And for the millennials, it's Skrillex. If you're listening to Skrillex, you're almost certainly a millennial, and there's almost no way that you're a boomer. If you're a millennial and you're driving around in the car with your grandparents, that's the artist to play that they just have no affinity for, if that's your goal.
Skrillex makes my toes curl. I work on the radio. I've had to play Skrillex, and every time when my ear catches it, I just think it is music to get mental health issues to.
Well, perhaps you would prefer some Roy Orbison. So he was the artist who skewed most towards boomers and least towards millennials. Pretty woman, walking down the street. Yes, Roy Orbison for the boomers, and that's who the millennials are not listening to.
I do like Roy Orbison, yes, I do. Yes.
Oh, his voice. I think you can't argue with the tone of his voice.
Back in Santiago, I wanted to find out more about the heritage of Chilean music and its political and cultural influences. I headed to a traditional restaurant in the back streets of the city to talk to music journalist Marisol Garcia.
Chile had a very strong influence from the Spaniard conquerors, so it has had difficult issue with its identity. We feel somehow that Spanish influence has been so strong, then Argentinian influence has been so strong, Peruvian, Mexican, American, that it has taken us a while to see what is really the Chilean essence. That mixture of influences is what makes the Chilean identity in music.
Tonight we watch a traditional dance being displayed in all its brilliance, cueca, which goes back a long time. And I know that you mentioned that Sting came to Chile a long time ago and wrote a song about a particular style of cueca,
yes,
which had been rooted in the time of Pinochet.
The cueca sola is a tradition that was born in the late 70s by a group of women that were looking for their men that had been detained and made disappeared by the Pinochet political police. And after a while, they decided to present this through the cueca and started dancing the cueca alone, just by themselves. So you could see a woman making the same turns and following the same rhythm, but not dancing with a man, just dancing by herself.
Yeah.
And it's a very powerful image because you can definitely tell that there's something missing there, you know? And then you realize that that woman has lost her partner. The police were here in Chile for a show in a festival in, I believe, in 1982. And Sting got to see one of these performances and he was very much impacted by it. So he wrote this song. The song is called They Dance Alone. and it's all about this hueca sola.
Politics has strongly influenced songmaking in Chile's past, and it still does now. I went to speak to the country's leading female rapper, Ana Tijoux. I asked her first about what she thought of Lollapalooza.
All those kids love, like, North American or English music. Like, I will ask myself if they love in the same way Bolivian music, Ecuadorian music, Brazilian music. We're in Latin America. I would love to see those kind of festivals with more Latin American music in the same equality of numbers. I'm not saying that English music is bad. I'm just saying that sometimes it's important about the identity. And we live in a country where you get to understand that, like, the dictatorship is not only about to kill people. It was not only about torture people. It's also cultural. Everybody wants to be someone else. And the question, who is Chilean? What is Chile? Who we are, the Chilean people?
Nos dices que debemos sentarnos, pero las ideas solo pueden levantarnos, caminar, correr, no rendirse.
I think we are searching something. We are still searching something. All of us. We are trying to find our roots, and that's why they take away from us. There is some, like, empty hole that we are trying to feed it, you know? So I think it's a research that we are still doing, and it will be past a long time to have those hole, like, full of not so much, like, question but answers. Latin American continent is a complex continent, and we are all so different to each other. Like, Bolivia is so different from Chile, Chile is so different from Colombia, Colombia is so different from Mexico. Every country is a universe. Every country is one identity. Latin American is full of poetry, and Chile is full of poetry. Like, the roots of Chile is Violeta Parra, Victor Jara, Pablo de Roca, so many of them. That is our roots and our pride.
To scratch the surface of musical identity here in Chile has been a mind boggle and an eye opener. I have met so many incredible, insightful, clever, tenacious, interesting people that are part of the music scene here, from new wave to experiencing Quaker dancing, a traditional folk wooing dance. It has been absolutely brilliant and a real moment to prove that the music scene has never been more global and more connective, and we are finding identity in being able to share music far and beyond here at the end of the world in this skinny country in South America. They're still making big sounds and big waves. Coming up in part two of Dolly Dylan or Daft Punk, we'll be hearing about how the music industry and songwriters move us with the songs we want to hear. This is Dolly, Dylan or Daft Punk. I'm Gemma Kearney, and I'm going on a musical journey from Chile to Uganda to Iceland to find out how music shapes our identity. Like the legend of the thing. Earlier, we heard how our musical tastes are formed in the womb and continue to evolve throughout life. Still to come, we investigate how great songs are written and why music travels around the globe.
The Lunch Beat on Radio 1 FM 90.
My name is Paula. I host the Hello Uganda show. I play either country or Afro-Caribbean music. The one song that has played over and over again is Dolly Parton's Coat of Many Colors.
Amazing!
Back through the years, I go wandering once again. Back to the seasons of my youth.
Why do you think that these songs resonate with a Ugandan listenership?
It just reminds them where they have come from, with who they have come along the way in their lives. And when you talk of Dolly Parton's Coat of Many Colors, it's basically through the poverty times, you know, that they have worked so hard to get from where they were actually at to now that they are really doing so well.
My coat of many colors that I was so proud of.
Country music keeps the soul. When you play country music, you feel at home, you feel free, you feel loved, you know. It brings us together. We decided to make a family of country fans because country music has a message, has a message.
Country music, first of all, is a gift to those people. It's like 30% of Ugandans love country music. And I call those lucky few people. The moment you get in touch with country music, you just know you're done. You never get out.
Those country music fans are pretty loyal to their chosen genre. When I speak to Elliot Van Buskirk from Spotify, he tells me who the most loyal fans are.
Heavy metal fans are far more loyal to their genre than any other genre that we looked at. And it does stand to reason, right? I mean, if you're walking around with a heavy metal t-shirt and you identify that strongly with that genre, it is a very strong identification.
So what makes a song globally successful?
I would have said that there are three theories.
Professor Martin Stokes is head of music at King's College London.
One being a kind of McDonaldization theory, which is to say that certain Anglo-American musical cultural products just travel the world in the same way that McDonald's and Marlboro cigarettes do and Coca-Cola does. There's not a part of the world that hasn't had the experience of listening to, you know, Madonna or Michael Jackson or what.
Yeah.
Another theory would be a theory of translation, which is to say that music circulates in all sorts of shapes and forms, but it gets translated into local idioms and sometimes with local musical instruments and sometimes with local ways of playing global musical instruments like guitars, for example. So country music has travelled the world. And I suppose the third theory is kind of a mixture of those two things. Certain things do travel relatively untranslated and certain things do travel and at certain moments become translated into locally powerful and significant forms.
Ultimately, it comes down to how a song is written in the first place. I asked John Seabrook, writer for the New Yorker magazine and author of The Song Machine, how songwriting methods have changed.
The singer-songwriter slash rock era was such a particular kind of a moment that was really started by the Beatles. There were many, many decades before the Beatles where professional songwriters wrote the songs for singers. Elvis didn't write his songs.
Born through a party in the county jail. The prison band was there and they began to wail. The band was jumping and the joint began to swing. You should have heard this knocked out jailbird sing that rock.
There was no problem with professional songwriters producing songs for professional singers. It was the way things were done. But the singer-songwriter era was just such a kind of romantic time when you had, you know, like Dylan and the Beatles and the Stones, and then the artists themselves were writing the songs. And, of course, that's just the dream, not only from the point of view of artistic creation, but also from the point of view of marketing, because, you know, you can kind of market these people as true poets.
From senators, congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't lock up the
But it really didn't last that long, and it kind of lasted as long as rock kind of remained vibrant and forward-looking. And now it's kind of over, and we're back in an era where professional songwriters write songs for professional singers.
So the times, they are a-changing.
Times certainly have changed. Far from music being written from the heart, some of the most popular songs are very formulaic.
The structure of the songs has changed from a melody and lyrics approach to songwriting to a track and hook approach to songwriting, which involves a producer making tracks on a computer and beats and adding instruments as he sees fit by programming them, and then getting these people who are called top-line writers or hook writers to come in and listen to a bunch of tracks at the same time and then add hooks, which are not exactly melodies. It's a melodic phrase, really. And the more, the better in these songs. And it was just a very different method from what I imagined songwriting to be. And I think what most people who listen to songs on the radio imagine songwriting to be.
Tell me, who is one of the best? Who
Max
do
Martin.
You...
Max Martin. Max Martin is the king. So Max Martin is a Swede. Max Martin has written more number one hits than anyone except for John Lennon and Paul McCartney, although he's a lot less known because he doesn't perform his own songs. It's actually a very interesting thing. He has a lovely voice. He writes these lovely songs. His first hit was Hit Me Baby One More Time. His most recent hit is I Can't Feel My Face for the Weekend. Right there, you have an enormous span from 1998 to 2015. No one has ever been able to produce number one hits for that length of time.
I bet he gets a lot of Christmas cards.
A lot of Christmas cards and a lot of cash, a lot of money, just a lot of money. And I know she'll be the death
of me, at least we'll both be numb. If we can all do it from our laptops, why aren't there more Max Martins out there?
A lot of this technology is, in theory at least, democratizing. You don't need to have a big room full of musicians. You don't need to have the money to hire them. You don't need a lot of expensive studio time. A lot of this stuff can be done on laptops anywhere. So in theory, that should mean that lots of different people can make hits. But in practice, there's really only almost a handful of people who can do it again and again and again.
I wanted to know more about how this supposed song factory works. I spoke to Hiten Baradia, who has written a number of hit songs. How does the songwriting process begin for a hook writer like him?
Whenever we're writing for a pitch opportunity for a major artist signed to a label, we're always given a brief as a starting point, and the brief is essentially what kind of song does the artist and the label want for that particular release.
A heartbreak song, another one.
No, it's not necessarily heartbreak. It's probably like they'll have a look at the top 10 charts around the world. What's number one in the UK? What's in the top 10 in America? What's being played to death on the radio? And then suddenly they'll say, OK, think Rihanna meets Adele and throw in a little bit of Justin Bieber. You know, the brief is so, so important for record labels. We did the first single for Little Mix off the last album, which was a song called Move. It was a big tune, and surprisingly big, because we never thought it was going to be that big. And the brief for Little Mix was totally different. But, you know, I think that when you spent 3 months following a brief and haven't really been successful with any of the songs because they're probably too close to the brief or not original enough, the songwriters in that session just said, let's just write something that we feel.
How important are the lyrics versus the melody versus the beat, in your opinion?
Oh, my gosh. I always compare a great song to a beautiful woman. You know, the first thing that attracts you to a beautiful woman is her looks. The first thing that attracts you to a song is the melody. And what keeps you from leaving is her personality. And what keeps you from leaving a song is the lyric, is the sentiment in the lyric. Songs appeal to three things. There are songs for the head, songs for the heart, and songs for the feet. And as a songwriter, if you can hit two of those at the same time in the same song, then you have the beginning of a formula for a song that's going to be worth something.
Are we swamped with choice, where there's just so many sounds and so much music out there that we are no longer led in a direction that's right for us, and it's no longer curated in the same way?
My answer to this, I think, is slightly counterintuitive. I think that we believe, or we like to tell ourselves, that the choices that we have as consumers of music in this day and age are infinite. That just with a tap on a screen and we are instantly wherever we want to be. I think that is pretty far from the case. Think about how much of our musical life revolves around things like YouTube, and think about how much of that revolves around the Roman alphabet. Now, if you can't use the Arabic alphabet, there's a whole bunch of things that you're never going to know about. If you can't use the Cyrillic alphabet to search, you're not going to be able to know about it or find out about it. Ditto Chinese. So our choice is constrained in certain ways. And I think that the role of curators of one kind or another is still an important one.
With language as a potential limitation, what are we searching for online? And which countries are the best at exporting music? Elliot Van Buskirk from Spotify investigates the data.
So we looked at which countries have an outsized influence on the global music scene. And we made a list, and it's almost all islands at the top of the list. Iceland is one of them. Jamaica, it makes sense, like reggae music is everywhere. And, you know, obviously all kinds of genres from the UK that have become global. The fact is that islands and peninsulas are just way more influential than they should be given their population.
I am now in Reykjavik, Iceland, here to try and delve into what is known by many as one of the hippest, most experimental, but rich music scenes on the planet. And I've come to a good place to speak to Siggy. Siggy's a bit of a local legend. He was in the Sugar Cubes. He was the drummer in the band with Bjork way back when. Now, he really is kind of a businessman, a go-to, a godfather for Icelandic musicians, and runs an organisation called Iceland Music Export. Let's head in, because it's blooming freezing.
My name is Sigtryggur Baldursson. We're trying to help the very healthy and active and interesting music community that exists in Iceland to do better business with their music. Because very many people here are actually focused on music for the love of music. And they're making something that they enjoy. And they hope that their friends might enjoy and whoever else. And they have pretty healthy role models if they start thinking internationally. Mm-hmm. And people like Björk and or Sigur Rós or even Monsters and Men. Because these are all people that have done music very much on their own terms and are not really very influenced by the market as such. And this, in many senses, has helped to mold what we view as sort of Iceland, or what other, especially other people outside of Iceland, view as Icelandic music today. It has its own sound, even though the sound is not very easily recognizable. It's more like an attitude. Working in the Sugar Cubes back in the 80s, early 90s, we formed a record label that was called Bad Taste. It was designed to challenge sort of good taste in arts and culture. Our band became internationally sort of known without us really sort of planning it that way. It was sort of an accident because the band was kind of a joke. And that became the Sugar Cubes.
Let's explore why in the last 30 years, Icelandic music has exploded onto the international scene. After all, this is a country of only 330,000 people. One of them who knows a lot about Iceland's flourishing musical identity is Jonathan Gardason. We met him at the national broadcaster RUV.
It took a long time to get Icelandic music across and out of Iceland and to have the world listening. It happened basically when Garden Party by Mezzo Forte, a jazz rock group, Icelandic jazz rock group, became a pop hit in the UK. That was in 1983. It went to number 17. That had never happened before. Three years later, we had the Sugar Cubes. And after that, the world has been looking at Icelandic musicians and artists and checking out what we're doing. But up until that time, everyone said, there's no way an Icelander will ever be popular outside of Iceland. It's so unique, it's so strange, the language is so harsh. That's not going to happen, but see what happened.
All over the world, we like strangeness.
Yeah, I mean, every nation has its own identity, and if you compare this one to the next one, you always see some strange things.
We're currently in the home of Arne Eggert Throdason. He's an authority on Icelandic music and a journalist and academic on the subject. We're in his living room. It's basically a library of vinyl records. You can't see the wall, you can only see books or music. I thought he was the best person to ask what lies behind Icelanders' diverse music tastes.
I'm sometimes amazed at
How can you sustain like a hip-hop scene or a heavy metal scene? Is it sustainable, you know? If you go to London, you can walk into a punk scene, maybe a sustainable, you know, a lot of bands, a lot of people. But here it's barely sustainable, you know. You have maybe 15 active heavy metal bands.
Mm-hmm.
But then it comes and goes in waves, really. It's like Reykjavik is that small that there's not an ongoing goth scene. It sometimes pops up 6 months and then it dies down.
And then suddenly everyone's wearing rainbow colours instead of black.
But you can go to London and there's always a goth wearing his Sisters of Mercy t-shirt somewhere. It's not going away.
So how is there such a magic here when it comes to making sounds?
The magic and what people from larger nations are sometimes a bit envious about is the micro-society factor. Because when you live in a village, you don't need to set up a meeting 2 weeks in advance. Because there's a big chance you will meet that person in the street.
That afternoon.
Or in the bakery the afternoon.
We're here on the outskirts of Reykjavik at a very special school called FIH. It's a jazz school and encourages people's musicianship, particularly from an amazing instrumental perspective. So I'm interested to get inside and chat to some teachers and some students. Does it surprise you that there's a romanticism about this element of Icelandic culture, that here on this island, all these sounds are sort of just coming up through the ground into the people's blood? Is that surprising? Is it funny?
It's kind of funny. It kind of sounds like the elves came to us and told us to write music or something. But sometimes it does feel like that, because I come from Hafnarfjörður. I used to live in this big house next to a lava field, and that's where I spent my childhood, like going into the lava field and exploring it and believing in the elves who were there in the rock. So it's kind of true in some way, but I think some people would say it's just ridiculous.
Yeah, sometimes I feel like it's very beautiful that people say these things, but sometimes I think it's gone a little bit too far when it's like all elvish and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's really funny when you also speak the language and are listening to the things, for example, the band Sigurós, which so many people fantasize about being like. And when you speak the language and hear and talk and have heard some interviews and spoken to some of these people, it's just regular people. It's just that you figure something out that you want to do, and you're not trying to mimic anyone, so you do something new.
We just stumbled across a practice, a rehearsal, which sounds delightful, and I've made a new friend.
I'm originally from Philadelphia, West Philadelphia. My parents are from Nigeria, and I kind of grew up in a cultural bubble, if you will. It's quite funny, actually. If you go upstairs and turn to the right, there's a room, and there's a gentleman on stage who plays flugelhorn. His name is Elvar, and he has a band called Bangura Band. And I met these guys a few weeks ago, and they're like, "We love Afrobeat. We make Afrobeat." And I looked at them, I said, "Icelandic Afrobeat? That doesn't make any sense, but I love it. I don't even care." Like, and the vibe is just so beautiful. They took that sound and they said they appreciate and love this sound so much. And it goes past anyone's claim of them appropriating the sound. They're appreciating it. They're loving it. They're actually trying to live it and trying to understand its origins, which is probably one of the most beautiful things I've ever seen in my life.
Nuzzled in one of the concert rooms in Harper, which is a huge concert venue in Reykjavik. The architecture is truly impressive, a kind of ode to the scape that you see when you look out from Reykjavik and see the mountains, and it mirrors that. Now we're inside. Tonight is the semi-finals of Music Experiments, a very important music competition here in Iceland, and things are hotting up, to be honest. I can feel quite a lot of adrenaline and quite a lot of tension as well. This is pretty, you know, slick, professional, a chance to play a big show to a big audience. Aru are competing, and we've just watched you sound check, and I'm gonna say that I saw you guys on stage, you look like perfectly pleasant guys, and then suddenly, nah! metal came screaming out of your mouth and from your instruments. Mm-hmm. Where did this come from?
People will probably think that we're not that heavy, but...
You like to surprise.
Oh, yeah, that's the surprising factor, yeah.
There are so many bands in Iceland that actually just come together to play this musical experiments and become successful because of this, like of Monsters and Men and bands that won in recent years that are touring the world right now.
And how long have you been in a band together?
2 years.
And how important is the music experiments competition?
Yeah, this is probably the biggest gig we've ever played. And, you know, then we go out of our comfort zone.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's really important to get that.
Today we've landed upon the old harbour. We can see Harper in the distance, the mountains are ever present. There are lots of lovely looking boats. It's pretty damn cold, but it's not picking us off. We're going to a traditional cafe as chosen by Georg, who is the bassist player of Sigur Rós.
I play the bass mostly, but we kind of swap instruments as much as we can.
How would you describe the sound?
Like God weeping tears of gold from heaven. that's actually something that someone said once that, you know, I found very funny, but very beautiful at the same time.
Yeah.
But I would never go so far as to describe it that way. The way we create music is usually we just need a little spark of something. It could be like a riff on a guitar or a piano or even a drum beat or just a sound that we find interesting. It could be even anything, like a car passing by, but it sounded strange. I guess the way that we work and the way we are as people and the way we interact with each other within the band, I think that affects the music more than where we are. I'm not saying that Iceland doesn't have anything to do with it. Mm. It's more that I think because we are Icelandic and we're brought up here, I have noticed that there is some sort of Icelandic mentality. I guess it's because of the way we are brought up here. It is slightly different than some other places, at least. So I would say that that is affecting the way we create and the sound of the music more than if we were on a beach in Cuba or something. The attitude towards the music that you're creating in Iceland, in general, I would say, is that you don't want to follow. You always want to lead. You always want to be original in some way.
What about language? Because you are a band that have broke... whilst not only singing some Icelandic, but also your own made-up language, Hopelandic.
Yeah.
You are such a huge export in many ways as a band. Sigur Rós are played everywhere, but it's nothing to do with language.
I still can't believe that anyone wanted to listen to us, you know, singing Icelandic. But I guess, I mean, music is that cliché that music is an international language. You know, I guess it is true, though. Sometimes music just explains itself without the words.
It's been an ear-filling, mind-boggling, playlist-expanding journey to discover that music truly is a universal language. I'm constantly surprised by how music can travel and be shared across borders transcending national identities. Curiosity, parental influence, nostalgia, fitting in with your peers, and political expression. All of these infuse our listening habits and tastes. So keep your ears open, because there's a rich and diverse world of music making out there, and it's at the heart of our identity wherever we are in the world.
On the last tour that we did some shows in places that we haven't been to before, and quite a few in Asia. And, you know, it was absolutely incredible. I still kind of have to pinch myself that we were standing in front of a huge audience in Taiwan or somewhere, and people were singing along to our music. In Icelandic.
You know? Amazing.
And it's just, you know, standing and looking at the front row of people and they're dancing and singing along to the music. It's just, how did this happen? You know? But amazing, absolutely amazing.
Dolly Dylan or Daft Punk was produced by Flora Carmichael and Peter Snowden and presented by me, Gemma Kearney. Thanks for listening to The Y Factor. If you'd like to hear more episodes, there's a wide range of programmes on our website. From pleasure to addiction, from the weirdness of water to our search for the secrets at the heart of the atom. Visit bbcworldservice.com/Y.